my God, I saw that for the first time. Oh my God, okay. We must get to sidestep matter. Okay, welcome back. Following the spate of kidnappings in the country, Cross River State Governor Professor Ben Ayade has signed into law a bill that prescribes death penalty for convicted kidnappers in the state. According to the reports, the anti-kidnapping bill was one of the 10 bills the governor signed into law at the state executive chambers, witnessed by the speaker and members of the State House of Assembly. Now, what are your thoughts on this? It's your view, Lady Count. You can call us on 070-8066-8014. You can tweet to us at TVC_ENT and please hashtag your view so we can get it, all right? At TVC_ENT, hashtag your view. All right. I think the real question here is not so much about the kidnapping, it's more about capital punishment, death penalty, and even NLC and TUC this morning is also asking for death penalty for looters, you know? So it's like, is that the way to go, pretty much? When death penalty, that's a pretty high price to pay for any crime. In this state, they're talking about kidnappers.
I do agree. Sorry, Nima. I do agree that it is intense, and even the United Nations is presently against, you know, capital punishment, not life sentence,
death penalty.
Thank you. But then the thing is, they haven't really brought about a solution to these things. And right now in Nigeria, I don't know about other African countries, this is a major issue: rape, kidnap, looting. People are really, really insecure. So if we don't have another solution to it, because the average human being, their biggest fear is the fear of death. So if you know that if you do this, you're going to get a death penalty, I think,
to be a deterrent.
Let me come to
the main objectives of every criminal law, that is every punitive law, is to either deter, rehabilitate, or, you know, reform the criminal. Now, most of the time when we try to, you know, just try to rehabilitate, we give those people who are hardened criminal, who are, you know, unrepentant criminals, the chance to continue. I've seen the death penalty being passed in Edo State by the Edo State governor, and it worked miracle, because at that time kidnapping was rampant in the state, but right now it is almost at a zero level. Even the countries are advocating, you know, no to death penalty, like in America, in the USA, for instance. Some states have passed these laws in their states. Other states put a moratorium, that is a temporary ban on it, for a period of time. Those states who have a moratorium have gone back to allowing it in certain states. So we see that it's always that aim of the law to achieve something with the law that, you know, that is affected when we try to take it out. I think, As a law in Cross River States, we'll see results, because we've seen results in other states.
But sure, even instead of the death penalty, shouldn't we reform our prisons to accommodate people? Because the truth is that if the objective is to reform, it's not about just killing people, say, oh, you're a kidnapper, you're a rapist, you looted the country, you're going to kill you. Why don't we rehabilitate these people and actually have them more productive? So I think we should probably invest our time and energy in ensuring that our prisons work, compared to what it is right now.
I totally agree with you. I don't think death penalty should be, you know, what
an option.
What should be the first option that they should think of? Now, what is the cause of kidnapping? What has made kidnapping go on a very, very high number in our country? Is because of poverty. A lot of people, when they kidnap, all they're asking for is money. America, they might kidnap somebody because the person doesn't just like the way you look, you know, and he kidnaps you and all that. But you see, in our country today, the main cause of kidnapping, robbery, looting and all that is looting. I will not include
greed.
I will not include looting. I would probably say kidnapping, you know, and robbery and all that. Those things is as a result of poverty. And of course, some people have also extended it to greed, you know. So if we are able to fix our economy, so, you know, when you know that you have put all options in place for me to get a proper job, I'm not making an excuse for these kidnappers, but let the federal government the state government, local government, provide, you know, platforms where people, when you invest your time and your energy, you get good returns for it. I am sure that it would, that measure alone would drastically reduce the number of people that are going out of their way to kidnap people.
I absolutely buy your argument, but then look at the period it's going to take to put up that reform. Mm. It's not something you do in 100 days, maybe not a year, maybe not even in 4 years. You can't complete this. So you want this to keep
a
going
simple
on
policy
up until...
Sazi can change the equation. A simple policy can change the equation. Where I'm a businesswoman. If the government tells me tomorrow, come and take 10 million naira or take 15 million naira, and at a very, you know, very, very minute interest rate for me to invest money and make better returns, you think I will not quickly run?
You're not
run
a criminal. You're not criminal minded.
No, I'm
let me give you an example.
I mean, if you put good reforms on ground, I mean, you can change.
Let me give you an example. You remember the kidnap, the woman responsible for the Magodo kidnap and the Surulere kidnap. Her husband is and his brother are hardened criminals. These people just want to take this money to live the life.
Large.
Not because, you know, they have responsibility. So those people are not necessarily motivated by poverty to kidnap. So for those kind of people, this is the mere fact that, you know, what you're doing when you get caught, this is the end result, is enough. I think that is enough punishment. That is the kind of punishment that they deserve.
But is that not against our who we are as a people, because we're very religious, we're very culture. We know in China, it's working for them in China, where But I don't think that has ever really been
let me also say something. You know, for me, killing somebody does not put an end to the problem. If you kill the person, you've got into a dead end.
Wait.
I'd rather we reform our prisons, reform all these agencies where we know that we can lock them up and drill information from them, because kidnapping is not just a one-man business. It is a cartel. A lot of people are involved in it. So if you kill one person, it doesn't stop kidnapping. Somebody else will look for a better way and a better technology to kidnap people. So if you keep killing people, you will not get solution. Even these Boko Haram members, I feel that if they arrest them and they drill them, they'll be able to milk out information from them. So, I mean, death penalty for me,
Truth is, there are just some people, and the people we're talking about, they didn't start today. There are people that a soft landing or reformation just would never do the trick. The only thing that would work is instill that fear in them that, look, if you do this, you're going to die.
What if the person doesn't have any fear?
If you don't have any fear, then you die. And we're
the
Boko
Haram
person who is already
working to, you know, fighting
towards
to die.
Death, so is it death?
What loss would the country suffer when you take him out?
No loss. The country will not survive loss. Walima, let me explain something to you. Now, if you tell that Boko Haram member that death penalty, you think the Boko Haram member, it will stop him from bombing?
It will not stop him.
But you apprehend him and milk out information from him. You'll be able to find out what is happening.
Now, let's come to what the governor did for kidnapping in his state. Now, we don't know much about why he did this. Maybe because he felt that Edo State government had done it
didn't work. They just relocated to other states. Do you understand?
So maybe all states actually implement.
So where would they? It won't change.
That's the result. They relocated. They
because
left
they were afraid.
The
Shaking
now.
Okay,
now the state is no longer.
Good morning. Good morning, Austin.
Hello, I'm first time caller. I'm very happy to hear your voice. I want to comment on what two ladies are saying. To be sincere, I'm 23. Well, I nearly kidnapped someone. To tell the truth, I nearly did. But I didn't know what just came over me. I've planned everything, but the person I wanted to kidnap is my cousin. So, but I don't know what came over me then, but I overcome it. But now, why I did that? Then, why I wanted to do it was because my uncle refused to give me money. I asked him, and he has the money. He refused to give it to me. So I planned on kidnapping
his daughter.
What
made you change your mind?
Well, I prayed over it.
Oh, you prayed over it.
I didn't just know what happened. I didn't know just what. I didn't know.
Okay.
Later, something. start right. telling me.
Do you have a job, Austin?
Hello, he said.
Do you have a job? Did you have a job at the time?
Yeah, no, yeah. Then I had no job.
You had no job. Okay, now I do yeah.
So I wanted to get money from my uncle to start up a business, but he refused to give me the money. So I wanted
okay.
to do something.
Thank
to
you
get
so
the
much.
Money.
We brought Pastor Itua here before, mm-hmm. and something similar came up where someone said, I didn't have any money to start a business. And Pastor Itua said, you know what? No matter how small it is, whatever you see, before anybody can give you money,
you have to do something.
You have
like
to.
That.
They have to see that with the little you have, somehow, mm-hmm. that you've been productive with it. So even with 1,000 naira or 2,000 naira that you have, you're now saving money. And they're saying that, okay, you've saved 100 naira every week. Mm-hmm. Just something. It shows discipline. It shows ability. Once you do that,
dedication.
Then someone says, okay, let me give you extra 10,000 naira. But you must be seen to be responsible. So don't always say, I'm going to collect money from one uncle. Before you go and meet the uncle, say, uncle, I have done A, B, C, D, E. Let him see it.
Even if uncle doesn't give you, it doesn't mean kidnap or whatever
yes.
will be the solution.
But
Elson's case for me is an I do mine's case. And I do mine's and the
devil's
workshop case. Now, extreme cases that I've seen is where someone is kidnapped and the person has a medical condition, the person is left to die and the body rots and then they now call the family members after collecting the ransom to come out. Those kind of cases would tell any lawmaker
yeah.
that the solution is definitely to deter yeah. and completely deter.
Okay, yeah. let me take Adesco from Lekki. Good morning, Ade, are you there?
Yeah, good morning.
Morning.
Sandra, you are welcome back in bed.
Thank you.
On the topic of the day, I would like to get into who was killing them won't take a lot of time. Because when you look at kidnapping this case, it's more a prospering business for some people. We had a very hot argument a while ago, family, and this corner was saying, how is it going to stop? That was going to Niger Delta. Because some people will just sit in their house, kidnap somebody after 2 or 3 days, because they are like 50 million. Now, it's because it's encouraging, so it continues to grow. The best way to eradicate it is by providing infrastructure, by creating
All right. It's so hard to hear you very clearly, but thank you so much.
Can I
like this Austin's case now. If they had caught him, would you have said they should kill him?
No. Let me even answer Nima. In Edo State, kidnapping did not stop. My friend's sister, my friend in America, when we traveled, she was telling me that her mother was to travel to America like tomorrow. They kidnapped her today. So they just quietly went to pay the ransom and they brought the mother out. Kidnapping has not stopped in Benin. It didn't stop them. They only went very, very low-key. You only make the kidnapper smarter. You understand? In a way that he would do it, and the ransom would not be too much that the people will not need to shout. Because, you know, so for me, I think focus on how to kill the situation from the root cause. Not
all
waiting
right.
for you to catch a kidnapper, and now you say you want to kill the person.
Okay.
Listen,
right.
I think in this Austin's case, if this law already existed and is being implemented, he would not even think of kidnapping anybody.
You think so?
Uh-huh. Yes.
You think so?
Yes.
He wouldn't even think about it.
He wouldn't think of it because his life is important.
He wants
to kidnap because he wants to make money to progress in the future.
You have a superior argument, but Sandy, let me tell you something. The level of decay in our country today, let the government, let everything start to work.
Okay, we have to go.
You will see that even the kidnapping on its own will just die. Because nobody has that energy to go and be kidnapping somebody. when I have a fantastic job playing out for me, let us fix our economy.
Right.
We have a lot of young people that don't have any job at
There's
all.
A lot of talk on the economy. Let's bring in our guests. Mm-hmm. Come on, help us. How exactly? Because we're talking about economy. Everybody's 100 days. They're removing us from rejecting us on JP Morgan. They're doing next. Let us talk. What exactly? How do we revamp this economy? Stay with us. We'll be right back.
I'm the CEO of Fit Gym Salons and Spa. I'll be coaching the ladies on their road to a size 10. And for that to happen, you have to stay focused and no pain, no gain. Be determined, be consistent, and remember that it's about fun. So have fun. Come on, ladies, are you ready? Yay!
Welcome back. Due to excessive reliance on crude oil to the detriment of other sectors, there has been a downturn in the oil markets, which has led to serious economic challenges. However, the new administration has promised to direct their attention to agriculture and solid mineral as alternative sources of generating revenue for the country. Joining us to discuss this is an economist, Mr. Sam Oluwadaisi Olisa. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you for having me.
You can call us on 070-8066-8014. You can tweet to us at TVC_ENT #YourView, please, #YourView. All right, sir. We've been hearing 100 days, Buhari did this, Buhari has not appointed minister, we're losing money. Where exactly is our economy headed to with all this?
If you look at it from a critical point of view, in the last 6 years, before Buhari regime, the economy, though inflated with petrodollar, but there was no development. What we had was growth. We have a lot of money, not adequately managed. Mm. So if people are now talking of 100 days, and they are making noise about 100 days, what of the 6 years? So what I believe is that the 100 days is still foundation laying. You cannot do miracle in 100 days. But I think the president is moving towards the right direction. The first thing you have to do is to block the loopholes, the shenanigans that has been going on the 6 years before now. Mm. Actually, oil is the lifeline of Nigeria economy. You know, about 80% of our foreign earnings comes from crude. And a lot of loopholes were there. I think the president is doing the right thing. First of all, you have to restructure the people that are going to manage these key sectors. The issue of appointment of ministers will come. Definitely, I said it from the beginning that it will, after 3 months, we will appoint ministers. He even specifically mentioned that in September, he will do so. So I don't think we should be in a hurry putting pressure on him on that.
In blocking all these loopholes, making sure that we get the right money, alongside the fact that petrodollar is dropping, would that be enough to actually resuscitate our economy?
I've been saying it, and I'll continue to say it. Even at $40 per barrel, the Nigerian economy would perform. You see, the price went up from 2010 to June 2014, hovering above $100 per barrel. If you look at all oil exporting countries, you discover that you can see the impact on the economy, except Nigeria. Even Angola here, you can see the impact. Even in Venezuela, Hugo Chavez was running a utopian government before he died. You can see the impact, except in Nigeria. We're supposed to build up our reserves. We're supposed to build up our sovereign wealth. But everything went down. Then there's something wrong somewhere. Before the price plummeted from June to December, it went down. And even analysts projected that it would go down even up to $40 before picking up again because of American share. What I'm saying is that even if the price is as bad as $40 per barrel, if you have good managers of the economy, we will still do well. It's because there are a lot of loopholes, which right now you can see the change in NNPC. You can now be hearing a lot. You can the NPDC, which is our oil shell, the one producing. There were a lot of malpractices in NPDC. For the first time, they went out there to bring somebody from outside the system, from NEPA, to head NPDC. They brought in their own company. I mean, the last regime, as a joint venture partner, to siphon away money. Recently, you can hear that NNPC is being owed over $7 billion. I mean, all those type of things, the president took his time to see that. Don't forget, he's not a novice in that sector. Yeah. So people should not stampede him. So we to move Nigeria economy forward, we have to block the loopholes. Well, now I'm so happy all the money have to come to only one central account.
So they can monitor
it. The receipt from LPG was not coming in there. A lot of anomalies was going on. Even if we're making, if the oil price was $500 per barrel, per barrel, at the rate we're managing it, there would still be nothing. Okay. In the national coffer.
In the fight against corruption, the president, the CBN has placed a limit on the amount of dollars that you can have in your domiciliary account and all that. And people have been criticizing that policy to say that it affects the poor man more. What's your take on this? Because you know we're a consuming country.
The poor man has the poor man access to dollars. Who are the people that took the dollars? The dollar went out of the system. That's what is known as money outside the banking system, which the banking system could not capture. During the electionary campaign, they were campaigning, spending dollars, the dollars moved out of the system. There are a lot of talk of dollars in the economy. So the CBN policy was to, you know, work like a trap. The dollar that went out illegally out there, so that it will not find its way back officially, round tripping. So people should realize that is what the CBN did. And that is why you cannot pay cash to your domiciliary account. Pay through the system. If your the way you got
your dollar is correct.
You don't need to be afraid. So I think by capturing it or trapping it there, first of all, that will have a short-term effect on the value of the naira, which we saw.
So, I mean,
it may not have a long-term effect, but immediately the rate at which the naira was going was too devalued, was too astronomical. So that is why the CBN did that. I commended that, but that is not all the solution to it. The solution to Nigerian economy is to look at what were other sectors. If I was reading about India, how did India developed? They laid emphasis on two sectors, agriculture, then steel.
Sir, I'm going
agriculture and steel.
Let me just come in right now, because I was reading a report where President Buhari was looking at other alternatives, and he particularly mentioned agriculture and mining. Agriculture, we've been working on it, we haven't gotten there yet, but about mining, how exactly is that going to happen?
Well, if you look at the Natural Resources Endowment of Nigeria, you have access to that map. You see that virtually every state in this country has one natural resource or the other. However, the mining is placed on exclusive legislative list.
Yes.
So our National Assembly members should promulgate law so that they can bring it to concurrent list.
Yes.
So that the states too can have access to mining.
Yes.
As I'm talking now, any state cannot mine because they have to obtain license from the federal government. So if you bring that to the concurrent legislative list, each state, you know, states are now emphasizing IGR. A lot of states are looking at tax.
Yes.
They don't go ahead and overtax your citizens because that will be additional burden.
But
you have to look at that mining. You cannot have joint ventures. We don't have the technology, state by state.
Yes.
So you now have the economy of your state on your power.
I wanted to ask, because I know also that there's a huge role that entrepreneurs play in any economy. If you want the economy to grow, I mean, you have to empower people to become, SMEs to become, employers of labor.
That's right.
How do you see the government coming in to help startups, you know, SMEs and, you know, individuals?
Thank you. We've been doing it in the past. You'll be hearing SME, different versions of SME,
but
we haven't got it right. So it's paper SME. The money, the disbursement eventually go to the rich.
True.
But with this regime, with the rate at which the regime is going slowly and going meticulously and looking at everything, that could be redesigned. I think the think tank of this regime should redesign SME. And they can collaborate with states. The states will collaborate with local governments. So that there will be a check on check. So that the actual money will get to the end users.
Yes.
In China, that is what moved the economy forward.
Yes. I know Vice President Oshibajo said something about it in the papers today. I just didn't read that article concerning SMEs, but I have to take a quick break. Before we do the break, let's take a few tweets first, very quickly. That's about three tweets each.
Most of the tweets are still on the last topic.
No, we still have...
Okay, Babatunde Omodara says, solution is to allow the naira devaluation so as to let investors flood our economy. Naira is at an artificial rate. I think that's the only one on there.
Is that correct, sir?
No.
He said to have a robust... Okay, sorry, Akim Amao says, to have a robust economy, we have to start producing things we need, I mean, things we need. Export. Import less and export more.
That's right.
Feed ourselves at least.
That's right. Mm. But the devaluation of the Naira, no country ever leaves its currency for free fall. Even Japan.
China did that.
Nobody. China, no, they will still protect it at a level. They still have inbuilt mechanism with which they protect their currency. How will you feel when you say we should allow the Naira to take its value and you wake up tomorrow and you say $1 is 1,000 Naira?
Hey.
How will you feel? It shouldn't be like that.
Let's take a quick break. When we return, more on this economy. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Yes. Well, you had a question for
I wanted to also ask that where does the banking sector come in? Because I know that SMEs, by the time you take up a loan, the interest rate is ridiculous. You know, you're just trying to make back the money and pay the bank the interest. So you end up finding yourself as a business person going back to the bank all the time to get funding anytime you want to embark on any major project because you're not able to save. You're just working hard enough to pay the bank both the capital and the interest rate. So where does how can the banking sector help?
Thank you. The banks are financial institutions that are out there to make profit.
True.
That is the first thing you have to know. They are not philanthropist organizations. Banks, they leverage. Banks leverage so much that the equity is infinitesimal proportion of the liability, the deposit liability, which is other people's fund. And let me tell you, if 1/3 of depositors of a bank run on a bank today, the bank will liquidate. So banks are so careful when they are lending. Then when you say SME lending, banks, they are very careful in taking risk. Because when you are lending to small enterprises without adequate collateral, then the risk level is high. But what I feel the government can do, the banking institutions are already there. They're already there as intermediary institutions through which the government fund can get to individuals, to entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. So the banks is to intermediate. So funds should be made available in large amount, either state by state, or geographical area by geographical area, through banks, through appointed banks that will now unlend to small-scale enterprises at a reduced interest rate. Alternatively, the government can provide guarantee, like in the 80s, we have what is known as the agricultural credit guarantee. And there is a sectoral allocation that banks must allocate a certain proportion of their deposit liability of their fund to agri sector, and to that extent, the government guarantees repayment. So that will encourage the bank to fund SMEs.
All right. The past administration tried as much as possible to diversify the economy through the agricultural sector and the film sector, the Nollywood sector, music and film entirely. Now, what do you think this present administration can do to, you know, continue that progress? Because we didn't see much progress with that initiation at that time. But what more can they do now at this time to take advantage?
I'm happy you said you did this. We didn't see much of it. I didn't see much of it.
So let me ask you from Bauchi State.
Okay.
Rukayat from Bauchi, are you there?
Yes, I'm a
morning,
first-time caller.
Please go ahead. How is Bauchi?
My contribution is mainly on the issue of bank lending.
Okay.
What? Bank lending.
Because I noticed that some banks, they give their customers moratorium. But why shouldn't that period of rest be attached to their interest? Because when they give you that moratorium, your interest is still haggard. You understand? So if a debtor really needed it, they should allow the person to rest for that interest too. So instead of giving you a moratorium, but your interest keeps piling up, it still has no effect.
That's true.
Yes.
That's my contribution.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Well, so, Asaha, that is part of what I say. Banks are out there to make profit. Because apart from shareholders, the bulk of the fund the banks use are depositors' fund. My 5,000, your 20,000, your 10,000, your 50,000. So banks don't play with it. And they will say, because we lend, we gave you a moratorium of 1 year, we will not collect interest. No. They will collect interest. So you have to look at your business critically before you go into it. You must look at the cash flow, whether it can cover your principal repayment and interest. That's why we recommended that government should provide quantum of fund to be disbursed through banks at very cheap rate. Government could absorb non-interest moratorium period.
Okay.
But definitely not the banks.
Israel's call from Gbagada. Israel, are you there?
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning.
God bless you all.
Thank you.
I always enjoy your program.
Thank you, sir.
And I'm glad today I've got you on the line.
We are glad to.
How is my good friend, Jumoke?
She's fine.
I didn't see her yesterday, and today the same thing again.
Yeah, you see her this week, don't worry.
Okay, in fact, that's my message to her. I always enjoy her contribution.
She's listening to you, don't worry.
Because in her contribution, she's always fair.
All right, are you going to comment on this topic?
Yeah, the topic...
You have 30 seconds, please.
30 days ago, you talk about 100 days of Buhari. I'm very, very optimistic that he will perform.
Okay.
Are you getting me?
Yeah.
So all your contribution there.
All right. Thank you so much, Israel.
So he has not answered my question.
My
question on the diversification of economy through the agricultural
sector. Okay, thank you. Yeah, you see, that is what we saw the last regime. They pumped a lot of money to, to agricultural sector. And even dry season farming. But we have not seen the commercial result, perhaps. It takes time. You know, agriculture, before you can begin to see result, when you invest in agriculture, it takes time. So that is why we didn't see the immediate commensurate result. However, if I know that this government will look at what the good parts of those policies and retain it, refine it, and improve on it, that by time we're counting, you know, 1 year, 2 years, we begin to see result accordingly.
Okay, so eventually, when Nigeria becomes, when our refineries start working at its full capacity enough to export, and then agriculture is booming and mining and other natural resources, when we become an exporting country and the currency keeps getting devalued, where does that leave Nigeria?
No, we are not saying the currency should keep on devaluing our currency. One additional advantage Nigeria has. Is that Nigeria is the largest market in Africa, sub-Sahara. That's why you see the Chinese, they're struggling to get in here, the Japanese, the Koreans, South Korea, the Indians, because the market is there. But what I say is that the life wire of this economy is oil and gas. Things must be done properly. For instance, when we fix our refineries, I will have additional refineries. Look at the stability we got now. It's because our refineries have started working.
At 60%.
And they are producing domestically. When you begin to import products, you are importing foreign inflation. Apart from that, you are creating employment for them out there. I don't know the reason why Niger, that has no crude, should have a refinery because they targeted Nigeria as a market. But when you once cross the border, we are using exchange rate. So now the present government emphasizing that have restructured NNPC, while the refineries are now beginning to work, and more are going to come upstream, that's a good thing.
Okay.
So you create employment at home. Apart from PMS, there's AGO, there's black oil, there's kerosene, there's every other thing that comes with it.
Unfortunately, we have to run. We have very little time, but let's take a few tweets before we run.
Omolaja Olatunji says, banks can't function well in a disjointed economy like ours. Every business is tied to the government. Private sectors run economies. Moyi Mofepe says, Well, oh, okay. Let me say, Oladipupo Sunday says, the principal solution to this problem is corruption tackling.
Okay, Nima.
Ademumi says, I think the economy will improve if security is tackled and investors will be ready to come into the country. PMB is trying. Then Omola Jalatunji says, even with low prices of oil, lots of monies are made from customs and port authorities. So blocking leakages is it.
Okay, so a final word, sir.
Yes, I think we've said it all. Even those that treated it, once the corruption is reduced or wiped out or reduced to its barest minimum, once there's security and our oil sector reforms is put in place, then we emphasize agriculture and other mineral resources.
Okay. Right. Thank
Nigeria
you
economy.
Human capacity.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure having you.
Thank you for having me.
All right, don't forget our road to size 10. It continues. We must hit size 10 by December. For those of you joining us, we'll let you know where we're meeting this weekend for our exercise. Don't forget to also catch our previous episodes on YouTube and then go to TV Entertainment and search for Your View. You can also watch other episodes on Google Plus. Also search for TV Entertainment and search for Your View. Bye-bye.